This is TV Ontario, Channel 19 in Toronto, Channel 28 in Kitchener.
Welcome to the Academy on Computers. This 12-part series is for anyone interested in finding out about this technological revolution and learning about who's using computers now and why. And the man who's going to guide us on our journey through the world of microcomputers has had a great deal of experience in the field. He's an author. He wrote the first book of KIM, a book about an early microcomputer system. He's the associate editor of Compute Magazine, and a frequent contributor to other magazines about microcomputers. And he's in demand as an author and lecturer throughout North America. It's my pleasure to welcome Mr. Jim Butterfield. Jim, welcome to the Academy.
Thank you, Jack.
Now, what can you promise our viewers and our participants if they stay with us for the next 12 weeks?
Well, we promise them a very close look at computers. We're going to have a hands-on look at a lot of these machines, a lot of varieties of manufacturers, computers of all sorts, and we're going to take a look at their insides, how they work, how they're used. We're going to take a look at some of their limitations, what they won't do and what you can't expect from them. In fact, we'll gain a bit better understanding and a better insight into the way computers work. We're also going to talk to participants, users of computers in the studio here, and find out what they're doing and what they think about computers. And last but not least, we're going to answer questions from the viewers, from the Academy participants, as to various things they'd like to ask us here.
Well, that sounds fascinating. When do we start?
We start right now.
All right.
Why don't we take a look inside this computer, because what makes it all works is the bits on the inside. First, we'll take out the plug here. Jack, would you hold that, please?
All right.
Okay. We'll open up the computer now, the power safely off, prop up the lid, and in here we see the circuit board that makes the computer work. Now,
no little man in there.
No little man in there, but right. Everything you see when the computer's closed is purely a illusion. These things are just attachments to the computer. This is a real thing in here.
Right.
We're disconnecting the keyboard. We've already disconnected the power supply and the screen. And here is a board which makes it all work. This is a computer processor board. This is a real computer. And on here you see the various chips that make the computer work. Now, I'm going to take one of these chips out and we're going to look even further inside to find the bits. Here we go. I'll pull out my little chip pulling device. And here it is.
This is the board that stores. This is the what they call the memory.
This is everything. This
right,
is a computer processor. This is a memory. This is a ROM that tells the computer how it works. All of the things that make it into a real computer are there. I'm going to take out this chip, which is a ROM chip, and I'm going to take the lid off this chip so that we can see inside and we can see what really makes it work. All of this is mostly packaging. The real workings are so small, it's quite incredible. Here we come. There's the top of the computer. Inside, can you see that little silvery surface in there?
You're right. All right, the shine.
Okay, that tiny little bit of silver in there, it's really silicon and not silver, is what makes a computer work.
Now, is that the bit, or are those the bits in there?
There are thousands of bits of storage in that part of the computer. There's a lot of information. Of course, each bit is only on or off, one or zero, true or false. And that's what makes computers so simple. They don't need a volume control because they don't have any halfway point. It's absolute logic, true or false, nothing in between. And that makes the logic very simple between the computers. But of course, a single piece of storage that says on or off doesn't tell us very much, Jack. What we need is to be able to put the various bits, as we call them, of logic together and to make new logic out of old. That's how we calculate. That's how we make new things happen. That's how we decide upon results. Is your bank balance overdraft, overdue, or something like that? You can tell all of these things by manipulating the bits into getting new bits. And the way we manipulate bits is to put them together through special circuits called gates.
We have on and off only. We have two parts.
We only have on and off. But by combining these on and off circumstances, we can get new on and off conditions that we've calculated that didn't exist before. So the computer's logic is making things happen. On might be, it's 8 o'clock in the morning. A second on bit might be, it's a weekday. And if they're both on, we have a new piece of logic that says, you're late for work. That's the way the logic works in here. Now, one bit doesn't store very much. Only on off, only yes, no, and that's right. Not terribly much. If you wanted to count, you could count to one and then you'd be stuck. That's as far as you can go. But by putting bits together, we can make much more things happen. We can store a whole letter of the alphabet or a piece of punctuation in usually a group of 8 bits called a byte. And very often you hear about the bytes of storage in a computer. That really means, roughly speaking, the characters that the computer can hold. And since we get a lot of storage in a computer, we often talk about it in kilobytes, which is thousands of characters of storage. So we have this kilobytes of storage, which is the thousands of bytes, each byte being 8 bits of memory that holds the insides of the computer. That's where it all works. That's where it comes from. And it all happens because the computer manipulates the logic that's stored inside it.
Could you just tell me about the gates again, the important part of the gate?
Yes. The thing about the gates is that you can have two separate conditions, two separate bits, one telling you one thing, one telling you another thing. And by means of a special circuit called a gate, you can take those two conditions and blend them together and find a new result, a new decision to tell you that yes, these two things have happened together, or no, they haven't, and you can create new logic by putting together pieces of the old logic. That's eventually how we do all of these things, like adding and subtracting.
Are all computers then basically the same with this board?
All computers are built along the same principles. If we're talking about microcomputers, then you'll probably find the processor, which does the arithmetic and the control on one chip, and you'll find various types of storage and connections to the outside world found elsewhere on the board. Even the big computers are really the same. They really contain the same element. Storage, control, logic, and input and output to take things out to the things outside the computer board itself.
Thanks, Jim, very much. Jim will be right back after we take a short break to show us other computers that we have here in the studio and help you decide if you need a computer and what it could do for you. We'll be right back.
TV Ontario is pleased to welcome our 10,000 registrants to the Academy on Computers and Education. By now, those of you who have registered in the Academy should have received at least 3 booklets: the Participant's Guide, the Educational Applications Handbook, and the Bits and Bytes Resource Book. Also included in your package is the computer printout, which is your personalized introduction to your course of study. A careful reading of the printout will start you off on the Academy on Computers and Education.
I'd like to show you a few of the computers that you can buy today in some of your local computer stores. There are so many of them that we can't hope to show you all of them today, but if you keep watching, you'll see quite a few other computers that couldn't fit in the studio here today. I'd like to show you some of these things and identify the boxes so that you can see what some of the parts are and get a better idea as to what a computer looks like when it's put together. Firstly, on my right here is the Apple II Plus computer. Now, we see the Apple II. The thing that looks like a television set above that isn't really a TV set. It's a monitor, and that means that you have to buy this separately, but you can connect an Apple to a regular TV set if you wish. A monitor gives you a bit better picture, but costs you more money. Over here, we have the disk drives. This is where you put your floppy disks in order to be able to read them. You see they come as separate boxes connected to your Apple by means of a cable in the back. Let's move on and talk about our next unit. This is the Commodore PET. We've seen this one before on this show. The Commodore PET here has a disk drive in which we put the disks. You'll notice that it's a single large box holding 2 drives. They call this a disk unit with 2 drives in it, and this is approximately the same as what you saw in the Apple, except it comes in one box. This is a cassette tape, and of course we've seen this in use before. We can load programs either from cassette or from disk. Disk is faster, cassette is more economical. You make your own choice. One of the things about the PET and some of the other computers that you'll see is that the screen that we have up here is built into the machine. It's a unit type of device. You can pick the whole thing up and walk away with it, providing you don't try to take the disk and the cassette at the same time. Let's move on to the third machine that we highlight in the hands-on section of our series. We have here the Radio Shack TRS-80 Model 3 computer. This one is totally a unit kind of computer. You see that the disk drives are here and are built in,
and you see that the screen is also built in. The entire unit is there, available. You can pick it up and carry it away. It's in one entire piece. We'll move on to a few units that we will not be talking about directly in the Academy hands-on material, but some of which you may have met. Here we have the Texas Instruments computer, the TI-99-4A. This one, once again, has a separate monitor that connects to it, so you can see on the screen. The keyboard, of course, as with all of them, is built in. And this one has the odd architecture that as you add pieces to the computer, you build them onto the end of the thing. And if you put enough pieces on this computer, here we have a speech synthesizer, an extra memory, but you can put more pieces on. Eventually, it ends up looking rather like an express train because the pieces just keep going on side by side. Moving on, we have a very popular, very economical small computer called a ZX81. This one is the most economical computer of all. It doesn't have color, and it seems to be a little more limited than some of the others. But I'd like to draw particular attention to this special kind of keyboard. This keyboard is called a membrane keyboard, and if you look at it, you can see that what we have here is not individual keys. It's a single sheet of plastic with the keys drawn on there. Inexpensive, quite popular. Another very popular machine that we see here is a Commodore VIC-20. The Commodore VIC-20 does have separate keys. It's relatively expensive, and like the ZX81, we can also attach this to a TV set. How do you choose between all of these computers? How can you make up your mind when there's such a wealth of choice? First of all, keep watching. You're going to see more about computers if you watch this series for the next 12 episodes that we have coming up. Secondly, decide what you want in a computer. You want a computer that fits your needs. Thirdly, if you really have to experiment, look around and try your hands at a small computer and see how you feel. Then you'll find out about what you're doing.
Thank you, Jim. Our studio guests are next. Jim, our guests in the studio are five people who use microcomputers every day. We have an elementary school teacher, an at-home user, a secondary teacher, an office automation consultant, and a lawyer. Let's find out what they've been doing with computers and what computers have been doing for them.
Good. I'd like to start out by asking each of our guests the same question. Tony, what's good about computers?
Jim, as a teacher, I found that having the computer in the classroom created much more excitement in the children than I'd ever seen before. And as an educator, I was also very excited because I saw the opportunity to truly individualize with this very versatile machine, and also to help me create an environment where I could help kids learn about learning and about thinking.
Well, as a freelance photographer and small businessman working out of my own home, I've found dozens of uses for it that I hadn't really expected. I can see that another 300 years wouldn't be quite enough to explore all the interesting uses I've found, but I use it for my business, I use it for graphics, I use it for typing letters, and everyone in our family uses it, and we all fight over it now because we need a few more of them to deal with.
Well, I'm a high school teacher. Although I use it for classroom purposes, the main interest I have in the computer is the fact that it's an instrument which can extend the field of activity of the mind, which allows you to experiment with your ideas, to present them in some format, to be able to play with them, to manipulate them, store them, and then do it all over again. And that's something that's unique in the history of humankind and is a tremendous cultural artifact, and I think that's what's good about computers.
Well, I deal with working adults, mainly office workers, and many of them are finding that microcomputers help them do their jobs better. For example, they can use them to collect information, to manipulate information, to present information in new ways using graphics, for example. And they're also using them to communicate with their fellow workers.
Difficult question to answer, Jim. As a lawyer, I'm finding that I'm using my computer pretty well in a whole host of applications that I could never envisage when I originally acquired it. The applications range from telecommunications to legal research to being able to do straight word processing, and the list goes on and on. It's really an exciting kind of instrument to have. You view it as a tool, you use it as a tool, and you try not to have that fear that people kind of feel is out there.
Pretty good. Have any of you found that computers have changed your thinking, the way you think about things?
I think just watching children, I find something very exciting again. I tend to think that the way I think is very much influenced by the medium that I used to learn, and that is a flat page where I read linearly. Whereas in children, I see the only concept I can use to explain it is mental space. It's very much three-dimensional, and a lot of bouncing off of ideas seems to be happening. Children seem to be playing with creative thinking as well as logical thinking. And all kinds of things seem to be happening that are very, the word again I'm going to use is exciting.
Good.
You know, Jim, the way I look at it is I try to visualize the situation in winter when I walk out and I sort of speak and there's a vapor that comes out and I can sort of almost see the words coming on. I wish I could actually have them crystallize before me and then be able to play with them and manipulate them. And in the computer, I actually have this capability where you can take a thought or an idea, put it into the computer, manipulate it, visualize it, present it in either pictorial format or in textual format or even a game format, and then you can freeze it and you can take your own thought and manipulate it and you can store it, and then later on you can come back to those same thoughts and manipulate them once again and store them and present them and keep them or else change them as you wish. And that's something that never was available to humankind before, and it's sort of like hearing yourself speak for the first time, seeing yourself without a mirror, just being able to get inside of yourself and become a human being in a more full sense. And in that sense, I think the machine paradoxically makes us more human than we ever were.
I see. Would anybody go so far as to say that the computer has changed their way of life?
I'd say it's made a fairly broad impact on my practice. After having introduced it to my practice, it's certainly lessened my work day to some extent. I'm able to do an awful lot of creation of documents in a word processing application, for example, which is probably one of the most useful applications that people have for computers. You're able to create documents, edit them, change them, revise them, do whatever you wish, and mark them up to your heart's content, either yourself or with your secretary working at the keyboard. And the beauty of it all is you can go through the whole logical sequence that one of the other people were talking about before, express your ideas, put them into a proper format where everything just follows so logically. It's a way of expressing yourself the way that you want to do it best. And the computer has really affected me to that effect.
Thank you, Lou. I'd like to address the next question to those of you who are in the fields of education. Do you feel that many people misunderstand the role of computers in education? They don't really understand what computers are doing in the classroom and in education?
Well, I think that it's possible that there are people who do misunderstand it. I think we're in a stage which is a tremendous transitional stage. The instrument is becoming available on a wide scale. People are beginning to contemplate its usage. They're beginning to try to come to grips with it. They're having to shuck some of their previous misconceptions, such as that you have to be a technical person, that type of thing. Those will only be overcome as they become more familiar with it, in the same way any other technology, through its familiarity, breeds the ability to use it.
In having done workshops with teachers, I find that initially they are very much intimidated by the technology, but once they begin to put their hands on it, usually I end up hearing that this is fun. They simply have to bring their understanding of education to the capabilities of that machine in order to use it effectively in the classroom.
Do you think computers in the classroom will change the role of the teacher? Well, does it change your role as a teacher?
Oh, definitely. The teacher, I think, is going to be much more of a facilitator, a co-learner with the child, helping the child to call on the resource of the computer. There are going to be all kinds of things, the kinds of things that Gord mentioned, you know, calling on databases to do research, calling on the graphics to maybe demonstrate an idea, calling on the programming capabilities to actually produce a product to share with another child, calling on a CAI system to learn a particular skill which they can then apply, and the teacher is there helping and guiding the child all along. It's the role of the teacher is going to become, I think, the role of the co-learner.
Very good. Some people seem to be afraid of computers. Do you find this in children, or do you find this perhaps in teachers? Are some of these people afraid of computers?
Well, I've taught both children and adults, and I find that adults are much more fearful. Mm-hmm. Children are willing to make mistakes, and that's a good way to learn about computers, because you learn more often from your mistakes than from what you were trying to do. Adults tend to have quite a bit of a fear of looking stupid, so they tend to sit back a little and wait for someone else to try.
Okay. Lou, I'd like to direct a question at you about business uses of the computer. Do you think that there are misconceptions as to how the computer is used in business?
Well, I think there are many misconceptions, Jim. Picking up on what one of the other speakers had to say, there seems to be this inherent feeling out there in the world that in order to use a computer, one must be conversant in programming. Forget it. Programming doesn't matter. there are readily available applications that one can purchase and run their business on. You can do all kinds of financial planning, for example, word processing, general accounting functions, researching information at remote locations over the telephone lines. There are just a whole host of applications, and one of the really unique things about introducing the computer into the business environment is the fact that half of the applications that the businessman or the professional will be utilizing have not yet been identified at the time of acquisition of that system.
Okay, thanks, Lou. When you have computers in your home, do you think there's a tendency that they just get used for games and really don't get used for anything else?
I think that's only one very small use, and certainly in terms of my own use, I play no games at all, but I found a tremendous use for them. Exploring ideas. I'm down in my darkroom working and something comes up, or it's in the middle of the night and I dash down to it, and this instant feedback that the machine can tell me something immediately, whether I'm my, and I've got all my thoughts and ideas put down on discs and they're up on the shelf and I can go back and look at them, and it's really quite exciting, and I'm building something that just keeps growing.
What would you advise viewers who want to know what to do if they want to go out to a store and look to buy a computer out there? Is there anything that they should know or look for when they go to make that purchase?
Yeah, I think they should first of all try to find, figure out what is it that they want, what do they want to use the computer for, and then try to find other people who bought computers for that same reason. But in my opinion, the key is to understand what it is you want it for, and then you can start to search it out. Then you make the purchase.
Okay, Lou?
I would say don't buy a computer until such time as you realize exactly what your intended use is. Research it. Look at all the magazines that are available on the newsstand. Gosh, there's a whole proliferation of them. Join a users group. There are no user groups that I know of that require you to own a computer prior to taking advantage of the resources that they have. Speak to people that are using them. Gosh, there's all kinds of information out there, and more importantly, there's a desire among users to share that information.
Thank you very much, guests, for your comments and your advice. Thank you, Jim. And after this short break, Jim will be right back to look in the mailbag and answer your questions. On Bits and Bytes next week in TV Ontario's Computer Academy, Billy Van and Lou Bagoy will examine ready-made programs, what they do, and how they can be applied in everyday situations. You'll be introduced to terminology such as ROM, RAM, hardware, and software. That's at 9 p.m. At 9:30, I'll be back with Jim Butterfield and his guests for further hands-on exploration. Next week, then, watch Bits and Bytes at 9 and join us at 9:30. Jim, we've already been getting lots of calls and letters from our registrants, and I wonder if we could take a look at some of their questions. Many calls on this one. If I don't have access to one of the three computers listed, can I still participate in the Academy? I do have a VIC-20.
You definitely can still participate in the Academy, even if you don't have a computer at all. The Academy here is for learning about computers. And if you haven't got one, perhaps the Academy may help you choosing the kind of computer you need. Now, if you have a computer that isn't one of the three models for which we provide programs, that's still quite all right. You can still learn and you can still use the information that we're telling you here. For example, the question here is about a Commodore product, the VIC-20. Now, we have a manual which deals with a Commodore product. Here, Jack, we have the manual. It's called a Hands-On Pet, a Beginner's Hands-On Manual. Now, this particular manual is written for the PET, and even though the programs that are provided to go with the PET don't work on a VIC or a Commodore 64 or other models like that, you can still use the program examples given in this book, type them into your computer, and they'll still work fine. These are simple examples. They'll work well. Just the tapes won't work. The same way, if you have a TRS-80, which is not the specific model of TRS-80 that we support, that is the TRS-80 Model 3, you'll still be able to use the examples in the book. You will not be able to use the cassette tapes. Those won't load into other models of TRS-80, but this will still work, and this will still give you a lot of information about your machine. And even if you haven't got a computer at all, you'll still be able to learn a great deal from the Academy.
All right, Jim, question two. Is it important for me to learn to program the computer in order to use it?
It's not essential. You can use the program without knowing anything at all about what's going on in there. But you might like to, for a couple of reasons. First of all, if you understand a little bit about programming, you'll have a better insight into how the computer works and how it's used. And secondly, at least from a personal opinion, I think programming is about the most fun thing you can do with a computer, so I think it's a really good thing to do.
And we'll be talking about that, right?
We'll talk about that.
All right, I have a TRS-80 Model 3, and the cassette you sent aren't loading. What do I do now?
Oh, dear. Well, where you have a cassette tape that doesn't load on almost any computer, there are certain things that you should look for, first of all. For example, some cassette recorders have adjustments on them. They might have tone controls, they might have volume controls, and if a tape doesn't load properly, the thing to do is to rewind the tape, turn your tone control up to maximum treble, try your volume control moderately high, possibly not right at the top, try it a few times and see if you can find some settings that do the job right. Now, if it turns out that for any reason you still can't get the tape to load, the next thing to do is probably try the tape on somebody else's machine. If you can, go over to a friend's, go over to your dealer and say, can I try loading my tape in your machine? See if it works there. It may identify a problem on your machine. Now, if after all this you still have a tape that still doesn't work, then what you'd better do is to send that tape back to the Academy and we'll replace it with a fresh one.
One cassette.
They send you a group of cassettes, yeah. Send in the one that doesn't work, okay. And that will be replaced.
I'm curious about CPM and how it could enhance a home system.
CPM, which stands for Control Program Microprocessor, is a very interesting thing, and we'll be talking about it in the future. Very briefly, Jack, it's a way that you can get many computers to be compatible so that perhaps you can transfer programs from one to the other. We'll talk about it a bit in the next program, so stay tuned. We'll be discussing that and many other subjects.
Okay, several calls on this one. I am not an educator. Will the Academy leave me high and dry?
Not at all. While we have a lot of educational registrants, we have just about the same number of people who are not from the field of education. People from business, the home, people who just want to learn about microcomputers. Now, we'll give part of the things that we do in the Academy over to educational considerations, computers in the classroom, and so on. But the big point here is learning. We're going to learn about microcomputers, and whether you happen to be involved in education or whether you're just somebody who wants to know, we'll have something for everything.
And here's a big one. In your brochure, the PET is mentioned, but no model is specified. Can you tell me which models will work with the Academy programs?
Okay, the Academy programs are intended for use only on the Commodore PET model 4016 and 4032. These programs are not intended to be used on other Commodore machines. For example, the 2001, the 8032, the Super PET, the VIC-20, or the Commodore 64. They're not intended for that. Only the 4016 and the 4032.
All right, Jim, what, very quickly, the question you're most often asked about computer world.
The one I'm often asked. Okay. Maybe it's about whether a computer can invade your privacy. Will a computer in your home invade your privacy? Answer, not at all. It's your computer. Nobody can look at it except you.
Thanks a lot, Jim. That's all the time for this session. Next time, ready-made programs. This is Jack Livesley with Jim Butterfield inviting you to join us again on The Academy.
Manufacturing Corporation and the following companies.